Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman. It's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Chris Gillum, and we're talking about Azure Functions, but not just regular Azure Functions, durable ones, right?
Yes.
That's the D in acid. Am I right?
Yes, that's right,
Scott.
I
went to school.
Yeah. Yep. So durable functions is it's an extension of Azure Functions, as you mentioned. It's an open source extension that you can just plug into your function app. In fact, I can show you exactly where you can find it in the portal here. If you are creating a new function, just go to this new durable functions section, and you'll see a couple of templates, you know, to where you can get started. So, what is it more concretely? Basically, it's a way for you to write function orchestrations in code. So, no designers, no JSON DSLs that you need to learn.
That's cool.
Just regular code. You can use your ifs and elses, your tries and catches and finalies, and you can write basically a workflow in code.
Don't we have other workflow things, though? Like there was, and I remember we talked about durable workflows in BizTalk Server, and then now that's in the cloud, and then there's Microsoft Flow. Where does this fit? When do I know that the Azure functions, the durable functions, are right for me?
Yeah, so typically you know this is right for you if you are looking to write code or if you're looking to do like really complex orchestrations that, you know, might not scale well in a designer environment.
That makes sense.
Like if you're doing a BizTalk or, you know, a Microsoft Flow.
Okay.
So one thing I usually like to do when kind of showing people, you know, some good use cases for this is I've got just pictures. I love pictures. They help communicate things. So one pattern that we kind of advertise is, you know, function chaining. So I'm assuming that folks, you know, have some familiarity with functions. And, you know, let's say you want to write a function app where, you know, you have some function F1, it does some work, and then it needs to call another function F2, right? Like you have some multi-step process that you want to automate. And, you know, typically, well, how do you do that today? You know, maybe you'll provision some queue. F1 drops a message into a queue, and then that's going to trigger F2. It does its work, drops a message, and so on and so forth.
Okay.
You can do this. It's a little clunky, though. You know, you've got to manage all these queues. You know, it's like, how do you keep track of the relationship between all of these? You know, let's say you want to add some error handling, you know, then what's that going to do to this pretty picture? It's going to, you know, start blowing it up.
Right. Well, it's very synchronous. I have to hold everything in my head, and really only I understand what's happening.
Right. So let's look and see what that would actually look like in code. So here I've got a Visual Studio project. I've got a function called, you know, E1 hello sequence.
All right.
And it's got this new orchestration trigger, which is part of this extension that I've added. Now, this extension can be installed via NuGet. But basically, what it allows you to do is it's going to give you this context object. And this context object allows you to call other functions in your function app by name, pass in some data, and then, you know, wait on that and get back some results. So this is kind of an illustration of how you could do that kind of sequential function calling.
That's clean.
So now you may ask, though, you know, well, what's the difference between doing this or just making a method call, right? Like, I see there's a say hello method, you know, right down there. Why didn't we just call that directly?
Right.
Well, what's actually happening when you call this call activity async, we're actually dropping a message into a queue, and some VM somewhere is going to pick up that message, and it's going to execute that say hello, and it's going to, you know, process it. You know, in this case, it'll process it right away and return some value, which then comes back onto another queue. So you get sort of a scale out, right? It may not happen on the same VM that your orchestrator function is running on. It may run somewhere else. Something else really neat is happening, too. When we do this await, which you see here,
right?
We can actually put this orchestrator function to sleep. Right. Let's say this say hello is going to take, you know, maybe 10 minutes to run. It's doing some really CPU intensive, you know, string interpolation logic. And, you know, we don't want to, if you're using the consumption plan, double bill you for this. Right. Like you've got this orchestrator function running. It's waiting for this say hello guy to complete. You know, you only want to have to pay for say hello. You don't want to have to pay for this guy while he's just waiting to get the response back. So we're actually able to put this guy to sleep, and when the say hello is finished, that's actually going to send a notification back to your orchestrator function saying that, hey, I've done the work, here's the result, please go ahead and resume, right? And so let's say you're halfway through your sequence here. You're trying to say hello to Seattle, and then, you know, maybe, you know, the VM
something bad
goes
happens.
Belly up, right? Something bad happens, and, you know, we need to recycle the process. Well, behind the scenes, we're actually persisting state. So we will start up again. We will resume this orchestrator function again. We will remember that, oh, we already said hello to Tokyo. Let's go ahead and skip that step now.
And what is it that keys off of that? Is it the fact that you're using a durable orchestration context that makes it the magic?
That's right.
Makes you pay more attention to that?
Yes.
And then the fact that you're using a durable orchestration context and using await and async on that context that allow you to sleep the orchestrator, the coordinator, mm-hmm. outer scope while these other things are happening.
Yes, that's right.
That's cool.
And so behind the scenes, this extension, it's basically dropping messages into Azure storage, you know, writing some history events to a history table. So it's keeping track of all the state, understanding what's been done, you know, what were the inputs and the outputs.
Are those queues and storages that are doing the orchestration, the thing that is encapsulated within orchestration trigger and the orchestration context, something I pay for, or are you just doing that as part of my Azure Functions experience?
So this is using your storage account, mm-hmm. Which gets created by Azure Functions. So you are paying for that.
Okay.
But the good news is, you know, it's nice and isolated from other people.
And certainly minimal.
Yes, and certainly minimal. You know, you're not ending up paying very much for this.
Cool. And the queue is also mine?
Yes. But you don't have to pay attention to those details when writing your logic.
That's what I wanted to hear.
Yes. So those are all just kind of behind the scenes things. If you peek in your storage account, you will see them, but you don't have to actually know that they exist.
That's pretty fantastic.
Yeah. So, but this is a really trivial sample.
Okay.
What gets more interesting is when you look at more complex examples. So let me go back to pretty pictures again. I'm going to jump to another slide here, which shows a more complicated pattern, which is, you know, fan out and fan back in. So
right.
For example, let's say you want to do some map reduce or something.
Right, and the thing about this is that fanning out's easy.
Yes.
I can fan out all day.
Oh, yes.
But when I come back, there's all kinds of rules that I might want. Like, I don't want to wait more than a couple minutes for this person to come back, and I want to give up mm-hmm. and just give me 2 and 3 and forget number 1 and all those kind of things. That's mm-hmm. that's hard work.
Yes, so normally there's a lot of state management that goes into actually implementing something like this.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was another problem that we wanted to solve and make it just trivially easy. So let's take a look.
I like it.
Jumping back into the code.
All right.
So here's kind of an example that I wrote, which shows fan out, fan in.
All right.
Basically, there's 3 steps to this. One, we're calling some function to give me a list of files. You know, in this case, we're going to back them up
yep.
into storage somewhere. So call a function, get a list of files. Then we're going to do a for loop on that list. And basically, we're going to call another function to copy those up to blob storage. Now you notice that we're not actually awaiting this call.
Yes.
We're just creating a whole bunch
of
tasks.
But you're putting tasks in an array, though.
Yes. So we're creating a list of all these tasks that we're starting.
Ooh.
And then down here, we do a task.whenAll, and we await on that.
See, man, this is the cloud. This is the promise of the cloud. This is why I get excited about the cloud, because you're doing what is almost kind of like task parallel library stuff
yes.
that came out years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And putting it out to the cloud. You are doing what is called a naively parallel operation,
mm-hmm.
or as Stephen Taub likes to call it, delightfully parallel. Naively mm-hmm. doesn't mean to insult someone. And
sure.
It says, there's n number of things here, and I don't care how they happen, when they I just want it done.
Mm-hmm.
This is the do it. Just go and do it, and I'll wait here until you're done.
Mm-hmm.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. And so we wait till it's done, and then once it's all done, you know, we can do some sort of aggregation on it in the end. In this case, you know, this function returns the number of bytes that we copied, and so maybe we can use the simple link method to do a sum.
That's
of all
really
the
clean. I want that on a T-shirt. I want this code on a T-shirt. Now, can I do other task.whens and make decisions about how long I want to wait for them?
Absolutely. I mean, you can do a task.when any,
mm-hmm.
for example, and combine that with another. A timer, a mm-hmm. durable timer that we support. Let's say you want to, you know, time out after, you know, a day. If it takes more than a day, you know, I want to go down some other code path.
But it's such a common pattern to say, I want to go and I'll give you 2 minutes or a minute and a half and mm-hmm. just give me whatever you got at a minute and a half and then I'm just done.
Totally.
And what happens, happens. Do I abandon the other tasks or do I just stop waiting for them and they continue?
So it's really up to you. Just whenever those tasks finish, that's when we're done.
And then I can go, and if the ones that I choose, not, if I say when, wait any, mm-hmm. The ones that haven't finished, I can choose to cancel them or choose to let them continue and then check on them later.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if I understand correctly, I'm only paying for the time spent actually doing work in the function. The orchestration waiting isn't something I pay for.
That's right.
So I can wait for a day, but I don't pay for a day.
That's right. That's exactly right.
That's hot.
Yeah. So that shows some of the patterns, and there's a few more advanced patterns, but I want to at least start out with these for the sake of time. So why don't we try running it?
Let's do it.
Okay.
Make it so.
And so there's a couple other cool things that we'll show here. So one thing that I did is I've actually created an HTTP trigger function mm-hmm. inside my function app, which is going to trigger any orchestrator that I want.
Okay.
So I better show you that so that this makes more sense. So I've got a simple HTTP trigger function.
Mm-hmm.
It's got this durable orchestration client
right.
object that it binds to. You know, as part of the route, I've got a function name that I want to start. And, you know, I've basically have the start new async that's going to mm-hmm. start a new instance of the orchestrator function.
Yep.
And then, you know, we're going to create this check status response. And I'll show you what that is in a second. But, you know, basically, this is a way that I can start a new orchestration.
Yep.
This could have been a service bus trigger. This could have been a timer trigger. I just happen to choose HTTP because that's really yep. easy
well,
to demo.
Well, for web hooks and things like that, it's a very reasonable trigger.
Absolutely. So now I'm going to send a post request to hit that. And so I've already deployed this function app to Azure.
Okay.
And so immediately I'm going to get back in a 202 accepted response. And I'm going to get a location header, mm-hmm. which shows where I can go and get status on this orchestrator that I just started.
Right.
Right. So we don't know how long this is going to take. Right. This could take 10 minutes. It could take 5 seconds. But we use the async model here to go back and
okay.
you know check on it. We also have a bunch of other information here. If you want to send events to this instance, if you want to terminate it, like hey, this thing is running away.
Or pull it and see how it's doing.
Right. So let's just pull it and see how it's doing. Oops, what did I do here? So I'm going to copy.
And the location is the same as the status query get?
Yes, it's exactly the same.
All right.
So I'm going to do.
And what is it? You're using HTTP. This is
better
than curl.
Yes, this is better than curl. It's HTTP PI.
All right, I'll get that.
Yeah, it's really useful for doing JSON APIs.
Brilliant.
So
Yep, completed.
Okay. Yes, I got an HTTP 200 back, which means it's done. And we get some information, including the output of that orchestrator function.
Your aggregated results.
Yes, completed, information about you know when it started and when it was updated. So you know an interesting thing about this is we implement that async HTTP pattern mm-hmm. as well. So you know if you have some client that understands that, like a logic app or whatever, you know we can kick these things off and pull to wait for them to complete. And eventually it will complete.
Cool.
So
and this is in preview?
Yes, this is in public preview.
So how does this work? I have to call you and you set me up, or I click a button? How do I get involved?
So let's see. You can go into the Azure portal. There's two ways you can do it. One, you can go into the Azure portal,
mm-hmm.
and we have some templates under the durable functions, and you can choose to get started with these.
Right.
The other option is that you can just go straight to Visual Studio, and you can grab our NuGet package.
Durable task, very cool.
Yes.
An extension to web jobs.
Yes. And so this durable task references the durable task framework, which mm-hmm. some people may have heard of this. So
yep.
that's what we're using under the hood to power all of this. But you know, once you have this, you have all the types, and you can just start plugging away and writing your functions.
Fantastic. Thank you for sharing. Yeah. All right. I am learning all about durable functions on Azure Functions here on Azure Friday.